Hello, Patreon. Welcome back to this month's Patreon collab. Today we're with Tracy and we're going to talk about digital wellness. Many of you guys know I recommended recently The Social Dilemma, which actually Tracy recommended. So I'm really glad to talk and discuss how to stay well in a digital world. Tracy, did you want to introduce yourself in any particular way, let the audience know kind of your line of work?
Sure. Definitely. So my name is Tracy Elizabeth McDowell, and I studied storytelling in university. And then from there, I realized what I really wanted to do was help people like move around their furniture and make themselves feel more balanced. So I went and got a master's in feng shui, and I began doing feng shui. But from there, I really had this moment of like, why aren't these things sticking? Because feng shui is all about balance and flow. It's an ancient Chinese art form, practice, philosophy about figuring out how to make energy flow the best or achieve flow the best. And I would set things up for my clients, but then I would hear the same complaints a few months later. And so I started going back in and realizing the problem was the technology. The problem was where their TVs were placed. So we'd move their TVs. Their problems were how often they had their phones with them. So I like invited them to set their phones in a different place, not near their bed. And as I did that work, I realized what I'm truly passionate about in this time period during the digital age that we live in is digital wellness. How can we be well with technology? Because like I never would have met Brittany if we didn't have tech. Like I love technology. I think it is a good thing. I just think we haven't been taught, and it's not built into the technology, how to balance it, how to feel good with it, how to interact with it in healthy ways. And so now my work is combining this ancient practice of feng shui and all the ways that we have to balance using feng shui with the research and the data and the digital wellness aspect. And that study came from the Digital Wellness Institute that I just completed my studies with, and I ended up teaching their digital feng shui course on how to like clean up your desktop and make things look better. So that's like the crash course on Tracy.
Well, I'm curious, because when I watched The Social Dilemma, which I actually really liked, I think it was really well done. I think the metaphors, the analogies, the way they like orchestrated the actors to kind of convey our emotional like conflict with ourselves and technology was really good. And regardless of, right, because for me, I think people focus too much on like regulation, and I care less about that. I focus more on what can we do as individuals. So could you kind of suggest that? Because I know one of the things I want to do with you after the few months go by and I can reorganize my house is have you on with me in a Skype call so you can look at my place. Because right now I know for a fact I'm blocking, I can see my furniture and I'm like, something is wrong. Like something feels too cluttered, but I don't have the eye for it. So what can we do as individuals to start the process just in our homes today?
Definitely. So the first one to start the process in your home today is ask where you leave your phone when you go to bed.
Okay.
That's the very first one. It's the hardest. And so I always want to preface this because I think people think it's terrifying to start looking at their technology, because our technology, like they said in The Social Dilemma, it's like a pacifier. It's like a safety blanket. Yeah. It's what makes us feel okay. It's what we grab when we're unsure. And so I always want to say it's like when you are moving an oven or you're moving a washer, you have to unplug the water or the gas first. And so the first thing you have to do is really ask yourself, like, what do I want to feel? And if you truly want to feel better, freer, more, I don't know, like yourself, then it's not that hard to take the step to move your phone away from your bedside, to stop using it as an alarm clock.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
So that's going to be a hard
like,
one.
Put it outside of your room or like in the corner of your room where you can't reach it. That it's like, you really have to start thinking from before the task I'm assigning, which is like get it away from your bed so you don't have EMFs near your head, so you're not distracted, so it's not keeping you up all night. All of those things I could talk about for days, but really you have to ask, like, do I want this change? Do I want to fall asleep without a phone? Do I feel good about that? Am I ready to embark on this mission? And then it's just like needing to turn off the water or the gas before you move a big thing like a stove or a washer, so it doesn't like explode all over you. You're not like, oh my God, this is too hard.
Yeah.
Because it's only too hard if you don't do the first step. And the first step is like, do you want it?
Okay, so I guess the question we have to ask ourselves is do you imagine then Gen Z is going to struggle the most with not identifying with their technology? Because for me, for us, I remember a very clear time without computers and without cell phones and without everything. So I knew I could exist without it. I had tangible evidence. Yeah. How do we explain that to newer generations who I think will probably suffer the most? I assume growing up with social media is not going to be the best for their mental health.
Yeah. It's going to be very different. I think it's hard to project that far ahead.
Okay.
Yeah. Everything that I've talked to with, like, Amy Blankson, who wrote The Happiness Project, Nina Hersher, like all these people in the digital wellness space, we can't predict how kids are going to use tech. But what we can predict is that, like, they are getting more and more depressed, more and more suicidal, more and more isolated, because they're not learning the skills to leave these safe spaces of my computer, my phone, where they have control over things, and go out into nature and be like, whoa, the wind can blow me over.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't have control over this smell, and that's weird. So I think that the biggest thing for that next generation, to answer your question about, like, they don't have context for it, is I think they're going to become annoyed with being cyborgs. They're going to see that they are, in effect, a cyborg. We always have our cell phone right next to us. Look how easy that was for me to grab. So I'm basically, you know, I basically have tech built into me. It's always attached to my hand. And so, yeah, I think that they'll start to not want to be cyborgs. I think we're already seeing with younger people and, like, millennials, this, like, push to go natural. So I do think there will be, like, an evolution of, I want wellness. What I'm getting given is just consumerism, and I actually want wellness.
You always hear this in the self-care industries. A lot of people will ask me, is self-care a capitalistic industry? And it is in America. You know, buy this, you'll feel better. Buy this, you'll feel better. Get this app, you'll feel better. And I guess my concern now, the number one question I know our audience is going to have, is they're going to ask, well, with shutdown, with isolation, how can we not be on our phones?
Yeah. Well, you can't. You need your phone to, like, talk to people and know that you're alive, they're alive, especially if you're by yourself. But what you can do that doesn't cost you money is feng shui, is declutter, clean with intention, and set up your space to support you.
Ooh, what does that mean, clean with intention?
Clean with intention is the same thing as that idea of, I need you to unplug the water or the gas first. It's deciding why you're doing it before you do it. So when I clean my office space, which I'm sitting in right now, the intention is always to support the next project I'm working on. So the project I'm currently working on is, like, I need a space where I can watch people who send me the videos of their homes. So I get these videos, they're anywhere from half an hour to an hour. I sit and I watch them, I take notes, and I say, like, oh, well, you need to do these 10 things, and, like, your life will feel more balanced or changed. Okay. And so for me, I need a space where I feel really good and loved doing that. My desk used to face this way, and so the doors were right behind me. My partner could open them anytime because we're in quarantine, so we're together, we're all, and I got so intimidated because I couldn't see him or know when he was coming in, so I shifted the desk this way. And then I'm deeply obsessed with this fern. She's like my
Is
baby
it alive?
Yeah. She's beautiful. gorgeous.
I know. Very beautiful.
So I keep her with this mirror that doubles her back to me, so I can see her, like, all day, and she's sort of supporting me.
Great.
And then, so for me, when I say with intention, it's what will make me work harder, not longer, not harder in a bad way, but just what will motivate me to do the work. And so for me, that's having this, like, beautiful fern, because then I don't feel alone. It's shifting my desk so I feel safer. I can see outside my window at who's coming. I can see outside this door at who's coming in here. And then I have, you know, I started putting up pictures of things that inspire me. I'm going to turn you real quick.
Yeah,
it doesn't mess anything up. Let's see if this.
Oh, love it. Girl with the pearl earring.
So, yeah, I have this, like, butterfly for transformation, girl with a pearl earring, because I have this vision of branding her as with a cell phone, taking a selfie, and a lotus, like, opening up.
Love it.
And so those are all the things I'm seeing. So when I say with intention, I want to call in like lotus, opening up balanced energy. I want to call in like butterfly, like transformative energy, spaciousness.
Yeah.
And then like this imagery of what I'm building towards is just right there directly in front of me. So intentional is what do I want? What do I need? And that's the hardest thing to ask yourself. Mm. And then building a space that matches that.
Now, of course, as many people know on Patreon, like I am an atheist, but I evoke spirituality and energy into my existence because I do think there is a clear science behind it. Everything is in motion. Everything is moving. We can feel tension in a room. We know when someone's having a bad day. We know when we're having a bad day. So even myself, like I keep now, okay, it's my turn now. I keep like, I have like this pine cone that I like decorated for Christmas. I have these art pieces I created that say like home is where the plants are, home is where the chickens are. I have this from outside because I just needed something that was alive or drying out rather. I have pine cones on this side. I have real flowers decorated all over. Like these are the orange flowers are real. Those are real dried flowers. Those are real roses. So I'm always trying to bring in a garden. Something alive, something living. And then of course I'm lucky I have a cat. So she brings life into my space constantly. And I love that. How do we explain to people that there is a balance between having a spirituality without sort of a religion, and then it matters, like there is a real science to making sure your space feels good to you, like really good to you with energy. How do we explain that to people?
Okay, so my favorite way to explain it is, I have two ways. The first is we've all laid down and done nothing. Maybe not since COVID. Maybe we have too much anxiety. We're always on our phones. But remember a time where you were in, if you practice yoga, shavasana, if you just meditate, you're just laying on your bed, and everyone is just laid on the ground at some point. And there's this moment where you stop being you and you begin to like diffuse into the environment. Mm-hmm. I think most people have felt this.
Yeah.
Where you become the sounds change around you. They either become so much more you hear your heartbeat, or so much more the environment. Energy is the awareness that if everything is energy, then we can play and transmute and change. Is it our heartbeat or is it the external world? And that we're so lucky to have homes and like four square walls where we can decide and control exactly what's happening in those walls. And that those are a reflection of us. And so the energy in that space is something that we get to decide. So I think of this balance of like, is it spirituality? Is it not spirituality? As being more, we are feeling sensory beings. And energy is so many of the things we feel. Like when you get shivers and you don't know why, and you're like, was that the wind? Was that, what was that? I'd call that energy. Your body is picking up on something you can't necessarily like make sense of in your brain.
Yeah.
Another good example that works well, because a lot of my clientele used to be like rich housewives when I lived in San Diego. So I was speaking a different language. I was speaking to people that were not part of like, I have a crystal sitting on my desk right here. Like they were not, that wasn't, you know, to speak their language. And I think of it as when you hold hands with someone, you can feel the difference between just your hand and like holding hands with someone. There is a major energy transfer difference that happens when like two bodies touch. And so I think as far as BDSM people in your world, this might resonate with them. When you don't understand energy, think of it as like you get to choose who you hold hands with. And so that is you being really intentional with your energy.
People feel, I find in, you know, my line of work, you guys know when you guys reach out to me on emails and stuff, or not emails, Patreon messages, those are different. But when you guys message me, I'm getting so many different messages, but one consistent theme is that I feel out of control. And like, for me, discipline and control is like my obsession, which is probably why I like BDSM, because it allows me to control and negotiate my boundaries. And the same thing with my house. This is the first time as a grown adult that I have purposely organized my room. I told Tracy the other day, I took everything out of my space, put it out into the living room, and then I put it all back almost exactly how it was, except for this chair. And this is the chair that I changed. I had an office gaming chair, really comfortable, but felt very industrial and kind of contradicted the garden feel of my bedding's floral, my walls are floral. This is now floral. I have a bamboo chair. It's my mother gave it to me. It's handcrafted. It's gorgeous. And this, I don't know how to explain it, but it completely changed the vibe of the room. Like, it was so dope. I just feel like a little fairy girl. Like, it's perfect, you know, for the space that I needed to create. And it made me feel like, okay, I could destroy this whole room and recreate it, but I knew, and I had moved with purpose almost the second time more intentionally, but I had already, like, my gut knew what to do. It's like we know what to do for ourselves, but sometimes we just miscalculate by an item. So yeah. I think maybe being cognizant to that is super helpful. In terms of technology, though, because I do, so my thing is, like, before bed, oh, look, even my phone is floral. Like, everything is floral. But before bed, I have a Pinterest, and I'm off Instagram and Twitter, but on Pinterest, I subscribe to, like, anime art and floral. So I look at plants before bed.
Yeah. But
I've noticed that there is a temptation to read the news before bed.
Yeah.
And so I have to tell myself, like, there's nothing there that needs to be read tonight. It's still going to be there tomorrow. Yeah. And that took me, like, a year, I would say, to not read the news before bed. So this isn't like a quick, like, get good, like, get peaceful quick scheme. Like, this is a discipline, work at it, but it's going to be beneficial. I think my skin is better. I swear to God, my mood's better. I wake up happier. Can you talk to that? Can you speak about how when you change your space, your mental health does improve?
Totally. Yeah. Well, I wanted to first say, it sounds like oftentimes what people need is permissioning. Mm. So much of my job when I was able to go into people's homes and do a feng shui consultation was them being like, is this okay on this wall? And I was like, does it feel okay on this wall? And they'd tell me all about it, and I'd listen. And by the end, they'd be like, I like it here. And I realized that my job was permissioning. It was teaching them to feel into their intuition. Mm-hmm. And I was just acting as a mirror. I was not telling them at all, usually, what they could do, unless it was something that really did need to be changed. Like, if you have leaky faucets or a huge open drain, in feng shui, water represents money. I want to always plug those. You know, there's big things in feng shui I immediately fix because they're just going to mess up someone's life. But for the most part, I think what you're learning is when you pull things out is you're permissioning yourself to have what you actually need, to feel into what it is you want. Because with the gaming chair, that's a very different energy. That's like spinning. That's like ungrounded. It's like on one stick. It's got rollers usually. Yeah. That is not the energy you and I need because we're already up here.
Yeah.
Like we need to be brought back down and feel really stable. Our feet can be on the earth, planted.
Yeah.
And that's not what everyone needs, but it sounds like you are finding the ways to permission what you need through moving things. And honestly, I think that the deep psychology that happens when you clean a space and then reset it up for you, not for anyone else, just for you, or if you have a partner and a family, for you and your family, you're learning about yourself in the process. You're like, do I need the swivel chair? No, that's not me. I don't need that extra energy, that intensity, that like openness of the mesh in the back. What you needed was like actual bamboo, so sturdy, but so like sturdy. Flexible. Mm-hmm. And then you needed like the cushion. And so I think it's beautiful. I think you realized what you needed.
No, I think you said it perfect. When I had the chair, it would just like come, and I was like, okay, you know what? Like I was always going like this. So I had a stress in my body. Like I could feel it where I was always preemptively waiting to spin. Cause for some reason it was just like a chair that spun. And I was like, okay, Brosif, like I need something solid. When I'm in this chair, the railing is kind of like this high. I don't know if you guys hear. It's like, you see how it's like, you know, I feel like I can grab it and I can get rid, I don't know. It feels like a cocoon, and I love feeling a little bit small. Now we talked about this in a private phone call where I said I had set up this room for myself. Like it clearly is a workspace, a sleep space, a shoot space. Like I also a meditation space. I meditate on the rug back here.
And,
like this is my space. This isn't a space I created with a partner in mind. I am single. So I know that if I shared the space, we would have done it together and our energies would have melded together. I think that that just stood out to me when you said it, because I think a lot of us forget. I keep meeting a lot of people that are putting their energy or their life on hold for that future partner, and I'm like, I feel like I would be stressed more if I was thinking about my space, which I only live in at the moment, for this invisible person who's not here yet. Totally. So how do you guess, I guess, how do you balance living for the future, living in the present, and having that fear of, oh, if I buy this furniture piece, I'm going to have it forever. Or if I buy this, like, how do you, I guess, how do we reassure people that it makes sense to live for the present and to plan for the future in terms of energy? Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense. Okay. I think actually I wanted to loop back before we answer that. And you asked about, you were discussing Pinterest before bed and the news before bed. And I wanted to talk about, as far as like digital wellness goes, think of it as you have two cups, right? And your technology, how technology is built, the person usually benefiting is not you. It is the person who is buying your data, who is seeing the scrolls you do, who is like, you know, keeping track of what you like and don't like so they can sell you things in the future. So if you think of it as two cups, every time you engage at night before bed in a phone situation, you're pouring some of your cup into the like universal technological energy cup. You're not helping yourself start to wind down or calm down. You're not pouring into your own cup. You're not like breathing deeply. You're not reflecting on your day. You're not journaling. I don't know what you do at night. I'm not a huge journaling fan, but for some people, that's the thing. You're actually taking away from yourself and contributing to a much larger energetic like map or grid, when really at nighttime we need to start like honing in on like us and bringing it in to us. So I just wanted to address, and I think before we jump to your next question, that if you can not have your phone on you an hour or two before bed, and you start training that into you, knowing that you are allowed that time.
Yeah.
That like 10 years ago, no one would have thought it was weird that you didn't call them at 10 o'clock at night or text them back or answer their email. Yeah. None of that is your business. So re-own that time. And start to like really hone in on what you need to feel good to go to bed. The other part that you mentioned was that you want to start looking at the news. It is so weird. There is no other thing in the world, maybe Disneyland, where everything you could want is in one place. Like, this is bizarre.
Yeah.
It's not normal. It's not normal at all. So the thing I start telling people that want to like look at cool stuff before bed is like find a book about gardening. Find a book with pretty pictures of whatever it is you care about, because all those things are going to get put into your brain. I did this mindfulness study for 6 weeks where they like scanned my brain at the beginning and the end. And it was very intense. Like every day for 6 hours, we did mindfulness and meditation and studying. Basically, one of the things I learned is like the things you take in before bed often will follow you. They'll be in your dreams. They'll like haunt you. So if you know that you need those things before bed to feel good for you, Brittany, like flowers and whatever, then it's so important that you have those. Just know that you don't need them on a phone. You could leave your phone on the corner of like the dresser behind you in a little box and like be done. You're like, okay, it's 10 o'clock. Like I'm getting ready for bed. I'm done. And like everyone starts to learn and know. People know with me, I have a message that says like, hey, I don't use my phone after 10 o'clock, but I will like contact you, you know, probably at 10 a.m. tomorrow. That's so I just wanted to like make sure I inserted those digital wellness nuggets.
That's exactly the key. That is the focus of this conversation at the end of the day is about digital wellness. And I do want that. And I do feel like Pinterest in my head, I'm like, oh, I'll have more variety of flowers. But the truth is like sometimes I notice that I'm like, oh, it's just like same photos. And so I'm scrolling longer because I'm scrolling through the same content I've already seen, which keeps me on the app longer, which keeps me seeing ads longer. And you're right. It is adding in that like subconscious stress. Like I heavily believe in that. Actually, I recently bought an art book from, you know how they do the coloring books from artists? And it's like a floral one. And I was like, maybe I should be like looking like coloring before bed or even drawing, because I've been trying to draw flowers lately. It's weird. It's hard to make them look alive for me, but I'm working on it. But it is one of those things where is that like sort of a replacement, I guess, for the digital desire to be on like to do this?
Yeah. So scrolling, the reason scrolling is addictive. You can read the book, The Hook Model, if you want, by Nir Eyal. I suggest it. Nir also has a book called Indistractable. I've talked to him through the Digital Wellness Institute. Cool. We've DM'd a few times. Like, his work is on point. He does a lot of research. The Hook Model says that anything that has the tribe, so like in social media, someone talking to you or sending you direct messages in Instagram or responding to a post, the hunt, which is scrolling endlessly. Oh my God, I'm going to get something. Just like you're playing a slot machine. Your brain just is like, I'll get there. There's one more. And the self, being able to put pictures of yourself and say who you are online. All of these things get us hooked. And then the thing on top of that that keeps us hooked is the variable reward. Just like when you're playing a slot machine, it's not knowing if you're going to get it. So you keep coming back hoping you're going to get it. Just like with friends, you never know how they're going to respond to the tribe. Just like with hunting, if you're fishing, like you never know if you're going to catch something scrolling. Just like with like posting a selfie, never knowing how people are going to respond to it. So all of these are the tech industry is purposely designing every single thing we interact with to be this type of addictive, this hooked. So okay. It's not just you.
So here's the question. Should we be upset at these companies or should we be smarter? Like what should we, I feel like people put their anger in the companies, and for myself, I'm like, how do I allow them to remain chaotic while I remain stable?
Something I loved about The Social Dilemma was that you realized that these people didn't know what they were creating. This industry happened in less than 30 years. It's so fast. And so, of course, the thing that they started solving for was making money. And how do you make money? You make it addictive.
Yeah.
No one was making a like button with the intention of it, like, ruining democracy.
You don't think so? Like, genuinely? Do you think they were genuinely, like, surprised?
I think they were genuinely surprised. Okay. I feel like there are interviews with the guy who was on the team to make the like button in this Social Dilemma, in other documentaries, where he's like, we were just told to make a button we thought would make people happy, you know? Yeah. We wanted everyone to say, I saw your picture, I liked it. We had no idea. The guy who started Pinterest, he is like, I will sometimes go home and spend 2 or 3 hours on Pinterest, knowing how addictive it is, knowing that I don't need to be on it, knowing I should spend time with my children. Everyone is in the same boat.
Yeah.
It is not worth, in my opinion, demonizing technology, demonizing these industries, because we can't change what has happened. What we can change, and this is a very feng shui perspective, a very yin yang perspective, what we can change is the things we do have control over. So you have a phone and you can change the settings so you do not get a ton of notifications every day. That's the first thing I tell people after move your phone.
Yeah.
So the second thing I tell people, turn off all your notifications. Who cares if you get a text? Who cares if Facebook wants to talk to you? Who cares if whatever has happened? Like, none of those. Your phone does not control you. Turn off your push notifications.
Yeah.
You don't need
that's
them.
That's changed, especially for Pinterest. Let me tell you, I uninstalled Pinterest in the beginning because it was so many push notifications. I was like, oh, now you're making me upset. Like, you're ruining my day by trying to get my attention. So I just turned off all the notifications and I only look at Pinterest at the end of the day, basically, which now I think I'll switch to the beginning of the day so I can start off with maybe some
inspiration.
For inspiration, because I don't spend a whole lot of time on my, even though I'm a social media, like I'm on YouTube, I spend a lot of my time filming and editing.
Yeah.
I don't spend a lot, because I don't have a lot of time to just scroll. But I'll notice, like, when I'm in restaurants, which I haven't done, during COVID, but you know what I mean. When I was at Disneyland, as an example, I remember I visited Disneyland 2 years ago, and my siblings and I were looking at a group of young people, maybe 20, 28 to 32, and they all had phones. They were all just like, and I was like, you're at Disneyland. Like, stop, get off your phone. Like, I have a rule when I go to Disneyland not to use my phone. Like, I'm allowed to take photos, but I can't post anything while I'm at the park. So I can document, but I cannot engage with social media. And I do that when I'm at the park or walking. Like, even yesterday, we were out for a hike in the forest.
Yeah.
And I took the Snapchats, and I was like, when I get home, I'll upload these. Like, I'll save them, and then I'll – so I could tell myself that what I'm engaging in with right now is nature and this moment in time. This moment I'll never get back. This moment I can't recreate, because when we do things, it's happening genuinely for that first time. So, yeah. But that took a long time of moving out of the cities and doing that. I don't know what it's like to feel the stress of living in a city and that desire to be like, well, my subway app is, you know, to get on the subway, I have an app. To get on the bus, I have an app. To get, so how do people, I just sound so crazy for people in the city to think like, can I live without my phone?
So I live in Brooklyn, and before COVID, I used my phone every day for maps, and it was absolutely necessary to get from point A to point B. And I think what's important to mention now, since we wanted to talk about digital wellness, is that like we live in the attention economy. Mm-hmm. So in case people haven't heard that word, it's really important to start integrating that we are the product. We are the product. Every time we pick up a phone, anything you're using for free, we are the product. Mm-hmm. The attention economy is all about our eyeballs being on our screen, creating numbers that can help generate ad revenue so that people can sell more things. That's the attention economy. And that technology facilitates that. And so once you know you're part of the attention economy, then it's about how do I become, you can either, there's two routes that are very popular right now. The first, digital minimalism. Digital minimalism, there's whole books on it, like go for it if this is your thing. Amazing. Digital minimalism is all about, I only need my maps, my Uber, my texting, my phone, maybe like my calculator. And those are the only things on their phone. That's digital minimalism. It works great for people. Honestly, I wish more phones were like that. And they are starting to design phones like that.
I know,
like
yeah, the basic flat phones. Yeah.
And Mudita. Mudita has a really good one if you're looking for one. Those exist. You can go for that. The second one is my sort of more feng shui approach. Be intentional about what you're doing each day. Like just that. Take that extra moment and know, okay, so I'm going to be on the subway for a grand total of probably an hour and a half today. So while I'm on, do I want to watch this TV show? Do I want to listen to this podcast? Do I want to scroll through this thing? Do I try to answer my emails? What am I going to do? Because I have this supercomputer in my hand, in my pocket, that I can do anything with. And be more cognizant. Yeah. So the phone is not dictating what I do. I'm not getting an email in the middle of like watching, I don't know, the L word, whatever you're watching.
Yeah.
And I'm not getting an email and then going, oh my gosh, I have to check this email. I'm going, no, I chose to watch the L word while I am on the L train coming home. Like,
yeah.
It's about the intention. And I think we've lost that. And I feel really bad for kids like my younger brother and the kids I used to nanny, because they don't have, like we started this conversation, they don't have practice with what was it like before tech.
Yeah.
So I don't think that they necessarily have the same stamina to say, I'm going to intentionally use this. But what I will say is I think with the younger generations, they have their own ways of coping and dealing. Like they don't use phones in the same way that people in their 30s or like their mid 20s do. They don't use phones the same way a 40-year-old does. Like they've already figured out their own systems.
Yeah.
So what we need to solve for and fix is like the people taking care of the next generations, us. How do we stay alive? You know, not suicidal, not sad, not super depressed, so that we can set an example of like life is possible balancing technology and ourselves.
I like that because I am a YouTuber. I do love technology. I do want technology to be a tool I can utilize to better my life, not to make it worse. And I am concerned that the depression rates and suicide rates and anxiety rates are super, super high right now. And I can't help but feel there's a lot of It's not just the misinformation of like what is a fact and what isn't on the internet. It's the image, the body issues, the knowing what value I have as a person if it does like separate from that phone or separate from what's on it. Like Instagram was really concerned with how women were seeing themselves through Instagram models. But for my brain, the way that I started to, because I noticed even myself, even my like, I feel like I'm so confident in my body image, but then even I'll go on Instagram and start thinking, oh, maybe I should get blank, 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 blank. And I'm like, whoa, wait a second. That's not even what I want. Why am I starting to think maybe that's what I should do? So it's about like also for me, just being self-aware that this is a journey that this person took. It's not a journey I need to take. But I can use Instagram and whatever else I'm using, whatever app I happen to like that day, like to my greater betterment. And I think intention is much more appealing to somebody like me than minimalism. I don't know if I could be a minimalist, but I know I can be intentional.
Totally.
So that feels like power to me. That feels super awesome. Like that brings me like very good confidence in terms of like, okay, moving forward. Yay. I like that a lot, actually. Now, I know since this is your life and this is something you've, you know, talked to me about many times in our private conversations, you must have a reason for doing it.
Yeah.
What is it?
what is my reason? I think I want to approach this very politically correctly. So, one, I love my family. Two, I'm very grateful for so many things that have been handed to me and worked well in my life. The reason that I have come to this is like I'm very queer. Like I'm very different and weird, and I always have been. I would say I'm like third gender, non-binary, fluid. Like I'm very much figuring all of that out all of the time. So I would say what brought me to this work is as a child, there wasn't a lot that I felt in control of. And so I really liked being bossy. I really liked like being able to like clean up my room and make it exactly how I need it. And so as I aged, I learned with friends that were struggling that if we tackled their closet, if we tackled their bedroom, if we redesigned the spaces that we have control over and we made them fit what we needed, that we would feel better. Yeah. You know, it was somewhere that we could take action. It was something that was worth doing. So much of like what the world tells us to do is buy things. And I think I just, that didn't speak to me. And so the need to feel safe is a huge part of my journey. Yeah. Learning how to feel safe as someone who feels very different, learning how to feel safe, with like a family that's very well-intentioned, and like tried really hard, but didn't necessarily like give me that support. It doesn't surprise me I ended up in an arena of life that is all about support. Yeah. You know, feng shui is just saying, what do you want? What do you need? How do we make your space support that? And so I think that translates directly into the digital world. I think there are so many people that are forgetting that like having 26 tabs open is going to make your head hurt. It's going to make you crazy. Having 3,000 unread emails, A, really bad for the environment. Like emails sitting in a spam filter create extra like CO2 emissions. So you're actually saving the planet if you delete your emails, but also just thinking about the fact that you have that many unread emails. We never would have had an inbox in real life with 3,000 papers stacked up. Someone would have fired you by now. So that's stressful for us. Like these digital spaces need help. And so I feel like I ended up here because I'm learning how to feel safe in them and like use them to support me rather than like let them use me, rather than be hooked on them.
Yeah. Do you, I wonder if it creates like a feeling of conflicts. Like I don't want people to resent technology. Or present the people who made the apps. Like, we're lucky that, I mean, I feel really cool that I was like, whoa, look at this world. I couldn't have met, you know, like you said, we couldn't have met each other without technology. We're so freaking lucky. Yeah. And at the same time, I just want to make sure that there is that healthy balance. I'm all about discipline. And I feel like there is a opportunity here for us to move with intention, like you've said. And I love that. I just love that so much, actually. I think I feel even reassured right now that I've been making moves that have impacted my life positively. And it's all about that intention. What do I want from this space? Like what do I want to feel every time I enter my room? And I do feel like every time I enter my space, I have two doors, and every time, no matter which door I come in, like you see that stick right there?
Yeah.
That's a stick I found on one of my hikes, and it's super dope. And I was like, bro, this is like one of my favorite things ever. Like when I walk in, I feel like Gandalf. Like I come in, I'm like, like I feel great and empowered. And then when I come on this side, like there's fresh roses and flowers that have been like dried. This is so hard to do, pointing my fingers and this thing.
But
like,
you're doing
right there, right there. It's like really nice. And I do want people to feel empowered. And it did not, I mean, guys, I buy my flowers legit. I go to stores when they're 50% off or, you know, they're about to die. And I'm like, great, I'm going to dry them out anyways. So it's not even about spending all of the money or all of the things, or even it's about collecting, or I'm really lucky where I live, there's a barter system. So if I want, I can trade X for X, like, oh, I need those fresh flowers, I'll give you eggs, or I want eggs, I'll give you flowers. It's a really beautiful environment. And so for me, I can easily balance what I add into my house. And on top of that, if I need, I can shop online, which is also a blessing. Like, I recognize that there are ways to use the app in that regard, or the phone in that regard.
I wanted to jump in. So please. I think that people forget part of why I love this work. So my dad is totally like, he's like MacGyver. He's like, he hoards fun things. Like, he likes to build and make things.
Yeah.
So I grew up with that, like, so much stuff everywhere mentality. And then my mom is like, everything must be perfectly clean. So I grew up feeling like I had to keep everything perfect. And what I want to say is, most people already have everything they need.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah. So I'll go into homes and people are like, I need to buy. And I was like, I'm not going to make you spend any more money. Like, you probably have the tables, the chairs, the lamps, the decor, the rugs tucked away somewhere, or your family you can borrow from. Like, you have access to everything you need. That's just how the world works. We wouldn't be here if we couldn't access the things we need. We just need to learn how to, like, ask for them and how to, like, use them. So as people start this work of, like, feng shuiing, if they reach out to me, if they watch feng shui videos, if they want to check out things I've written, it's about you doing the work to declutter and release the things that do not serve you anymore.
Yeah.
And once you've done that, you're going to be like, oh my God, I only have things I love. Whoa, this is so easy to decorate with. Because if you only have the blanket you love, the dresser you love, the chair you love, then that's your whole room, but it's all things you love. It's all things that inspire and lift you up.
Actually, okay, most random thing, but that totally reminds me. I have a lot of, like, covers and guest covers, and I used to have ones I didn't like, so I would purposely, like, avoid them and be like, I'll just have those in case I need them. And I got rid of everything I didn't love and everything I didn't use within 6 months. Like, every 6 months at least touched it, so it would, you know, be useful. One, it totally helped my mental health. And two, it made me realize that when I am online and I see something I like, I think to myself, but will I use this? And will I want to use this versus will I buy it just to have it? And it made such a difference in my life, actually. So I'm really glad you brought that up, because I noticed that I did. Now every blanket I love. So it doesn't matter which one you hand me, I'm going to love it. It's such a different feeling. I don't know. Does that make sense?
It's such a different feeling. I had a girl that I had a huge crush on tell me, she goes, well, when we first moved into this apartment, she goes, well, if you only buy your favorite things, they'll all fit. They'll just all they'll look so good together. And I was like, God, this so great. She's so great.
Yeah.
She's so right. I kept practicing that. I was like, I'm only going to get things that are my favorite. And so they might not seem like they're going to go together to someone else, but, like, because they are my favorite things, they do go together.
Yeah.
They do work really well together. And they are what make me special. And you start seeing, because our environments are a reflection of ourselves. You start to see yourself in your environment in a way that you love.
Yeah.
So then the self-love starts to, like, grow.
Ugh.
It's so beautiful. So for me, like, I have my partner gave me this, but I have this ridiculous tape dispenser, right? And you're like, there's no way this is going to look good anywhere. My desk is a bit messy today, but guys, this thing matches my desk.
Oh my gosh, it matches all your pens and everything.
So well, because they're all things that I use, that I love, that are my favorite, that make me feel good. And so it's really about your environment is such a reflection of who you are. So right now, if you feel shitty in it, it is your job to go in and take out everything that isn't serving you, that makes you feel heavy or gross or you don't like, and say, like, hey, thank you. This was really, you were useful for a period of time, but not anymore.
Yeah.
Just the same way of clothes, the same way you'd get rid of food that doesn't suit you, all of it. The same way you cut off your hair when you need a change. Like, we're getting rid of the weight. We're saying thank you. Like, thank you so much, hair, for making me look feminine. But, like, I'm ready to look like Justin Bieber again, please.
Yes. Like, I feel that. No, my mom does the same thing. My mom literally just had my sister just came to visit. My mom said a whole bunch of stuff. She goes, I'm decluttering. My mom is the least clutter person I ever have met. And I was like, what do you mean declutter? You have nothing. Like, she has exactly what she wants. My mom is very, she goes, I'm done with this period of my life. And I was like, because it's been about a decade. And my mom's like, I'm getting rid of all my furniture. You can have it if you want. And I was like, yeah, I'll take it. Because I think now it's time for me to have time with it. And then when I'm done with it, maybe I'll pass it on to somebody else. Because that's the thing too. I don't put too much emphasis on buying the new things. My emphasis is on sort of like the energy of the old, which is why I love this bamboo furniture my mom gave me, because it feels, it's just got so much good energy in it. You know what I mean? It's really helped solidify the environment. Now, Tracy, we're coming to the end of our little time together. So I want to make sure you've said everything you need to get out into the world. So my audience, so we as a online fam have a chance to really learn from each other. Is there anything you want to make sure you say to everybody?
Yeah, there's two terms that I learned when I was teaching and taking studies at the Digital Wellness Institute that I want everyone to know, that I want them to become normal things. So the first one is fubbing.
Okay.
So fubbing is when you're in a conversation, it'd be like right now, if I started doing this to you, and I'm like sort of talking and you ask me a question and I'm just like, this is fubbing. When you ignore someone by holding your phone in front of your face or only paying attention to your phone.
Yeah.
Fubbing, I think, is going to be the number one issue that we deal with younger kids, is that if babies grow up and this is what they see, then the thing they're going to value is this. They're going to value the phone. They're not going to value the person because they're not seeing a person. They're going to value the phone. So fubbing is not using your, like, actively being aware of when there's another person and trying to be present with them instead of your phone.
Love it. 100% love it.
The second one is nomophobia. It's exactly what it sounds like. No more phone. Nomophobia is when your phone is not near you or it's taken away. It is a actual, like, researched, scientifically understood, documented thing. People's bodies will have a reaction like they, you know, got their favorite toy taken away if they were a kid, or like they lost a partner. Like, our body, we are so attached to these devices because they are a lifeline in so many ways that when they're not with us, we're like, oh my God, it's that phantom phone or like the phantom rings. That's all real. So I just want to be clear, it's all real. It's all being studied. It's all being documented. Like, as we age, you're going to keep hearing and noticing, like, fubbing become a normalized term and nomophobia becoming a normalized term, because they weren't designed ethically. They weren't designed to better humanity. They were designed to sell things, and they were designed to be sexy and cool and make money. And so we need to start having autonomy and being really clear on, I will use my phone intentionally for these things to advance me, and everything else, no thank you. And I also want to be clear that, like, I'm not perfect. You know, I'll still binge watch like 5 hours of TV. I will still doom scroll for days when the world is on fire. Those are things that are hard to overcome.
Right.
And that you're not alone overcoming them. I literally study this every single day, and I teach it and I work on it every single day, and I still get sucked into Instagram spirals, or, you know, like, I don't even have Facebook very often. I'll open Facebook, I'll get stuck in it. So it is going to be hard, but it's not impossible. And I think that the point of power is being intentional about what do I want and what do I need.
I love that so much, Tracy. Like, I really do. I feel that too. I don't feel like perfection is not something I'm interested in. As the great philosopher Beyonce said, you know, perfection is a disease of a nation. I'm not interested in perfection. I love that. That intention, I always say discipline, but I think intention's a better word. I think intention is something I should add to my vocabulary, is like, what is my intention here? And am I acting on it in my best self-interest for my joy? My therapist always said that, like, seek out your joy, Brittany, no matter, even if it looks like something you didn't think your life was supposed to look like. Maybe it's not like the greatest iPhone. Cause I've never thought about, like, oh, what phone should I have? And then somebody said to me recently, like, oh, you have like an Android. And I was like, oh my God, is that a thing? Like, is that a thing? I should not have an Android. Like, there's that pressure, even in the digital world, to have the best of the digital things, even though my phone does the same thing. Like, my phone accesses the internet. And yeah. I feel that pressure. I see it in people where they, it's like the new Jordans. It's like the phone, yes, the new Jordans. It's like weird. Yeah. It's different. But I can feel it on my body. Like, I can feel the tension, and I don't want that, you know, for people. I want people to feel intentional and in control and then joyful.
Yeah, of course.
I just want a joyful pie for everybody.
I'm with you.
Dude, this was beautiful. I'm so glad we got a chance to talk. And I wanted, because this is your life. This is something that I really admire about you. Where can people contact you, seek out your services? Can you let everyone know?
So I have a company called Nested Feng Shui, like build yourself a little nest, based on feng shui principles, but it's now also infused with digital wellness principles. So if you go there, it's very clear under sort of seasonal offerings, all of the things that I have done for clients and that I continue to do for clients. I feel like I would love to offer for your peeps, Brittany, because we're probably in line in a variety of ways. I can give them like 25% off a house audit. So basically that just means they film their house and then I tell them what the best digital wellness feng shui changes are, just 10. Oh, cool. Easy, so they can do them. And usually I do those for $99, so whatever 25% off of that is, I'd love to throw that out there so that people are getting what they need and have access to me and these bits of information, because I think it's really, it's like the more people start taking control of their space, the easier it is to take control of yourself.
Oh, I believe that very hard. Like, to be clear to everyone listening, I believe that more than anything. As somebody who basically survived her environment for most of her young life, this is the first time in my life I'm like, I need to control my environment and I need to make sure it's joyful when I'm in it. So I will link all of your information, Tracy, on the description of this video and make sure everyone has access to it. And I think it's important. And if we do our session, maybe we can even share it so people can see how my experience was. Because I know, I can feel it. There's something here. I need someone else's eye. I need like a, you know, another joyful person's eye to kind of help me through it. Thank you so much for spending your morning with me. And I'm just so glad we got a chance to communicate this to everybody.
I mean, so much of what you teach, say, do, it's just such a portal into like passion and truth and like authenticity that I have always appreciated. So I'm so grateful I got to be here.
I love it so much. Okay, guys, I hope you guys enjoyed this and we'll talk to you soon. Bye.
Yay. Bye.